we will discuss the history part and then get on to examination. All right?
Sure. Yes. So here I'm presenting the case of a 14-year-old girl child, second born to second degree consanguineous married couple hailing from Tumkur, from Karnataka, religion being Hindu, and informant was mother who was reliable, and she was admitted to a hospital on 2nd of this month and examined on the same date. She came with complaints of fever from 6 days, vomiting from 1 day, altered sensorium from 1 day, and one episode of paroxysmal movements in the morning of
presenting. Ashray, we will stop here only.
Yes.
Okay. See, the fun of clinical medicine is to start thinking right from the first word that comes out on the history, right? And I think that teaches us a lot. So I want other students on the chat or on the live platform to be also active, so that it's not only the presenter and not only Ashray who is going to answer all questions. We are all going to be discussing together. So besides Ashray, is there anybody else who wants to consider? Now look at the fun. This child has fever for 6 days, but first 5 days, there was nothing other than fever, right?
Yes.
And it was only on day six that vomiting was followed by altered sensorium and then some paroxysmal event.
Yes,
let's imagine you were there in the first 5 days of fever when you did not know what was there in the offing on the day six. What would be your thought? I can see anybody else on the live chat or chat box? Anybody who wants to kind of opine, surely Ashray will talk, but let's all join together to discuss. Anyone wants to say anything about fever for 5 days in this elder child? Yeah. Ashray, what would you think?
So initially in the 5 days, we still did not have a clear diagnosis or etiology, sir. So we would expect the fever to manifest itself and treat the child symptomatically as such, sir. Diagnosis in the initial period.
You are absolutely right. But your first statement that we may not know what may be the possible etiology is not very right. We must try to know the possible etiology, not very definite diagnosis, but some idea about which group of fevers are we discussing. So now at this point of time, without further slides, give me some details of fever.
So
like an undergraduate, tell me everything about fever.
So in this child, sir.
Yeah.
So in this child, the fever initially was a low grade fever, sir. It was intermittent type. And since she had fever on the first day, she went to a local clinic and she was started on paracetamol, sir. So on taking paracetamol, the fever was relieved. And along with the fever, after the relieving of the fever, child used to feel better as well, but only to recur after around 6 to 7 hours, the fever used to recur back, sir. So this was the pattern of fever on the initial 2 to 3 days. From the 4th day onwards, along with the fever, she had along some amount of malaise, weakness, and headache also started, sir. Headache was also almost moderate type, and it used to relieve partially on taking paracetamol tablets. So,
all right.
This was the nature
of
fever.
Now we have heard about the fever. Now you said it was a low-grade fever, really,
yes,
right? Now what does low-grade fever mean to you? Does it convey any meaning, or it is just a routine inquiry that we talk about high grade, low grade, intermittent, remittent, recurrent, whatever? You gave a good history. Now,
yes,
I want you to consider, what does this low grade fever mean to you?
So low grade fever means it is either some amount of underlying bacteremia which is there, which is yet to manifest, or it can be of not as any significant fever, mild viral illness, something like that, sir. So that is what low grade can tell us.
Excellent. I think you said it so well. What you meant was, it was a low grade infection.
Yes, sir.
and not just low-grade fever. Okay. Yes, could it have been non-infective inflammation?
Non-infective, yes, sir, possible, sir. That also could have been possible, but the pattern of fever might have varied when it was a non-infective
inflammation. Excellent, excellent. Yes. Non-infective inflammatory fevers generally are high fevers.
Yes, sir.
And this was low-grade fever.
Yes, sir.
And therefore, this must be a low-grade infection, either viral, bacterial, parasitic, fungal, whatever. Okay, we don't know as yet. But so your first impression that you gathered with the statement that it was low-grade fever meant you were dealing with a low-grade infection. Okay, yes, now tell me, were there any other symptoms of viral infection? Common symptoms of viral infection are cold or cough,
cold or cough.
Some low stools or vomiting or headache, body ache. If there was none, and then the next question you could have asked that, is there any contact with a similar illness in the family? Because yes, viral infection spread very fast. Okay, be it dengue, be it COVID, okay, whatever. But they spread fast. And therefore, if there were none, then it was not likely to be a low-grade viral infection. Okay.
Yes, sir.
If not, then could it be a low-grade malarial infection? Before we go on to low-grade bacterial, let's rule out low-grade malarial. What do you think about low-grade malarial fever?
So even then, in that case, low-grade malarial, they would have had high-grade fever associated with chills, rigors.
All right.
All those features might have been present, sir.
Okay. See, remember that in malaria, the manifestation of fever and a pattern of fever depends on what is the general immunity built up against malaria in that child. For example, malaria is endemic in our country. This child may have had not one, but two, three episodes of malaria in the past. And this must be the nth malarial episode in which the fever pattern may not be with rigors or chills or whatever.
Fever would have and been irregular, sir, in that case.
Yeah. And therefore, what is peculiar about malaria generally is the fever is erratic.
Yes.
Now, you said that every 6-8 hours, the fever comes back again. So, looks like this is not a very erratic pattern of fever. And therefore, it is less likely it's malaria. Okay. Could it be a fungal infection? Low-grade fungal infection?
Low-grade fungal. So fungal, then other risk factors associated with fungal infection was not present. So she was a healthy child. Then no treatment with any antibiotic, chronic antibiotic or steroids or anything as such, sir.
Excellent. So you are trying to tell me that there is no immunodeficiency state.
Yes.
Or immune suppression due to drugs. And yes, therefore, it's not a fungal also. So now, see the fun of medicine. We may be wrong, doesn't matter. But this gives you an idea of what thinking power you and me can have, only if we use that. Now, on day 5, I have made a diagnosis of a low-grade bacterial infection. Okay, now, name a low-grade bacterial infection. Let's go one step further.
Typhoid would have...
All right.
Presented.
Okay. Typhoid typically is low-grade to moderate fever. And by day 4, day 5, it has a ladder pattern, which means it becomes very high.
Yes.
Okay. And what is more important is an illness like typhoid, which is really an acute bacterial infection. Okay. Is child is sick when there is no fever, but yes, in many other conditions, child doesn't appear so sick when fever comes down. So if this child is not very sick looking, especially when the fever is controlled, this is unlikely typhoid.
Yes.
Okay. Then which other low-grade infection you know? Because typhoid is generally a high-grade infection. Okay. But yes, he may be partially immunized, might have taken a typhoid vaccine. Okay, so we will not simply throw it out. but less likely. Which other low-grade infection you know of?
E. coli, like UTI presenting, that also won't be
UTI. UTI presents really, if it's an acute upper UTI, which is pyelonephritis, which high would grade. Be an high-grade fever. And if it is a lower urinary tract infection, there would be, besides fever, there could be no fever at all. But besides fever, the local symptoms predominate, like frequency, burning, that were not here. That and now, not. At this age, first episode of urinary tract infection, pyelonephritis is unusual.
Unlike this.
So this is not UTI. Then what else? Then what else is tuberculosis? Low grade.
Tuberculosis, yes, sir.
Okay. So now we have almost built up a story of a low grade infection, which is bacterial and which possibly may be tubercular. Okay. Now, I'm sure we may be totally wrong, but doesn't matter. Our thought process has to be right. Okay. And if our thought process is right, we are invariably right. But if we are proved to be wrong at the end of that story, then I must look back and learn, where did I think wrongly? That's the way to learn medicine. Okay, so we are learning. Don't forget that at the end of 53-54 years of practice, I am still learning. You are not even 50 months of learning. Okay, so you can imagine, you can be so much boldly wrong. I can't be boldly wrong. People expect me not to be wrong. Okay, but even then I am wrong. So let's believe this child is likely to be TB. Well, there could be many other infections which we cannot guess. But what are we discussing? We are discussing the typical way the child presents. And we came to conclusion it must be low-grade bacterial. And in our epidemiology, TB stands. Okay, so this must be tuberculosis. Let's believe that. Then your next symptom you mentioned was headache. Now that headache is often associated with high fever, but when headache is associated with low fever, you are almost pushing it onto a neurological symptom because there is no low-grade fever with headache. Okay, now can still there be a low-grade fever with headache? I told you that it must be neurological. Okay, logic demand. Would you tell me any other cause of low-grade fever with headache? And so that could be...
Vasculitis or immune-mediated cause?
Vasculitis where? Vasculitis is the general term. Okay. So you would have said low-grade sinusitis.
Yes.
Now, often sinusitis is a chronic disease. Okay, because you have a chronic running nose, blocked nose, adenoid enlargement, and you have a host who is susceptible to sinusitis, and he has got a low-grade infection, and he complains of headache. So now, if somebody complains of headache, and this child is pretty elderly to give a right history, you could have asked, where is the headache? Is it on the frontal sinuses? Is it on the maxillary sinuses? Very difficult to point out a site of headache in sinusitis, but maybe an occasional patient could guide you exactly to a diagnosis of sinusitis. How do you rule out the possibility of sinusitis? By asking them the nasal symptoms. Sinusitis is a complication of a nasal disease. So you would have asked, so do you have a recurrent running nose, blocked nose, okay, snoring at night, keeping mouth open? Now you are building up a story of a low-grade sinusitis. If this child did not have anything, then possibly this headache is neurological. And imagine before vomiting came, before a paroxysmal event came, we knew that this is likely to go towards the neurology, right? Now yes. Come further. You have a low-grade bacterial infection, which is now localizing in intracranial compartment. Okay. Give me a diagnosis.
Now we can think of any bacterial, low-grade bacterial Streptococcus pneumoniae, Neisseria meningitidis.
So now tell me, intracranial infections could be commonly meningitis or encephalitis.
Encephalitis, yes. Sir.
Which is this one? Is it meningitis or encephalitis?
Meningitis, sir.
Meningitis, okay.
At present, now, with headache.
All right. So when you started getting headache, you could have said it must be meningitis. We have not still defined the etiology, and we have already said low-grade fever is tuberculosis. So we might start thinking whether this is going to be a tuberculous meningitis. Okay. Now comes vomiting, which substantiates that it must be a neurological disease. Okay. So yes. Now so far, we have tuberculous meningitis on our card. Okay. Now, what does this paroxysmal event mean to you now? Which part of the brain is involved?
So now the cortex is also getting involved, sir.
You said it was meningitis.
Yes.
Okay.
Sir.
No, meningitis doesn't involve cortex so early in the course of this. A typical meningitis in an older child remains as meningitis for a long time, even if not treated. And only at the fag end of total absence of any treatment, the child would start developing a cortical or a brain involvement. Otherwise, it will be restricted towards meninges only. So now what is this? Do you think this is an encephalitis?
Yes, encephalitis picture is also coming, sir, now with autoencephalorum and paroxysmal event.
Okay. But now, before I asked you about the paroxysmal event, you were sure it is meningitis. And now you are changing to say it's an encephalitis.
So most of the infection, they'll have both meningeal as well as...
Excellent. So this is a meningoencephalitis.
Meningoencephalitis, yes, sir.
And what is the commonest cause of meningoencephalitis? Tuberculosis.
Tuberculosis, yes.
Okay. Now, there would be a differential diagnosis. But if you saw 10 or 100 such patients of meningoencephalitis coming on day 5, day 6, majority would be tuberculosis in our epidemiology. Well, we'll go by that. Okay. We are not sure about anything. The point is, to learn clinical bedside medicine, you have to go on thinking. And more you think wrongly, more you have learned every time. Okay, it is said that you learn because you make mistakes. Okay, but at some time then you must stop making mistakes. That rarely happens. Okay, but anyway, making mistakes is a way to learn. And how do we make mistakes? By trying to think and voice. Okay, so yes. Far so good. I want you to learn this power of thinking. Okay. Otherwise, everyone who has entered medical college has left successfully after getting a degree. And same is about the post-graduation. Okay. But the real examination comes when we start practice, that each patient is our examiner. And he comes without telling us the curriculum, without telling us whether it's a short case or a long case, and asking all funny questions. Okay, imagine you will be giving every day, several times, examination for your life. But MD is only eligibility to appear for such repeated examinations. Okay, and therefore you must be thoroughly prepared for those repeated examinations. Right? Now go ahead.
So one of the doubt was, sir, why low-grade? Yeah. Temperature has evening rise of temperature.
All right. Very good. What happens is normal body temperature rhythm is least in the morning and a little high in the evening, because our physical activities make us raise body temperature by about a degree or a degree and a half Fahrenheit. So in the morning, I am 97. degree Fahrenheit, and in the evening, I am 98 degree Fahrenheit, which is the normal body rhythm. Okay, now I start getting low-grade fever because of low-grade infection. My morning temperature becomes 98, 1 degree more. But I say that's not fever, that is below the arrow. And the evening temperature becomes 98 to 99, and I report a low-grade fever. So low-grade fever only means low-grade infection. It could be low-grade sinusitis. It could be low-grade UTI. Yes, you said all that. But low-grade UTI and low-grade sinusitis have associated symptoms, whereas the low-grade tuberculosis may not have a localizing symptom. That's why it is low-grade. But don't forget that TB can come with a very high fever also of an acute onset. Are you aware that TB can come with high fever of an acute onset, almost mimicking high-grade fever? So you would have said high-grade infection or high-grade inflammation, non-infective. Okay. So any pathology of tuberculosis which is immune-mediated strongly can present with an acute onset of a high fever indicating high degree of non-infective inflammatory response to tuberculosis. And this typically happens in a very healthy child who develops a sudden episode of a pleural effusion, comes with a very high fever, and in the next 12, 24 hours, he comes with breathlessness because of a severe inflammation, a lot of fluid accumulates, and it goes right up to the whole pleural cavity. And a patient presents within 24 hours with high fever and breathlessness, simulating an acute infection, but this is acute non-infective, acute inflammation triggered by a low-grade infection. Now, this is the only time that you have high-grade fever in an inflammatory response to a tuberculosis infection. Now, tell me, which are the other types of pathology which also are largely inflammatory response to tuberculosis infection? One is pleural effusion. Now, I'll ask you another question on the same line. In which type of tuberculosis treatment do you use steroids?
Meningitis.
Excellent. So TB meningitis is also an inflammatory disease. Okay. But the inflammation may be minimal to begin with. Could be only vasculitis. Could be only affecting some small part of the brain. And therefore, the fever may or not necessarily be low grade. Fever could be even high grade. And such a patient who starts with low grade fever may also start showing higher degree of fever, indicating an inflammatory response to a low grade infection. And wherever you use steroids in TB treatment, it is because of trying to suppress the inflammatory response to the infection. Right? Good. Go ahead now.
History of presenting illness. Patient was apparently normal 6 days ago when she developed fever.
Now, wait a minute here.
Yes, sir.
I know that by habit, we all start saying apparently normal. But I want you to now henceforth say genuinely normal. So how can you make out whether this child was really normal or parents thought that the child was normal? That is what you mean apparently.
Yes, sir.
So now, how would you have confirmed at that point of time only whether this child has been not a very healthy child or rather a sick child? How would you have found out?
Based on her body status, one is looking at her build of the body, sir. Like thin, emaciated look, all those things points towards apparently normal child, sir.
Before looking at the patient. And don't forget that somebody who is very thin may be healthy also.
Yes.
Okay. And
for activity, we need to ask.
Very good. Excellent. You ask for a personal history. You ask whether he has a good appetite, he has not lost weight, he is active, he is energetic, he is happy, he is playful, his bowels are all right, urine is all right, he sleeps well. If all these point out to a normal child, then I know that he was reasonably healthy. Thin or fat doesn't matter, but healthy. Are you aware whether this child was healthy or not healthy?
Yes, sir. This child was healthy, sir.
Healthy. Oh. Yes. So, if he was healthy, we are not sure whether this is going to be TB. But yes, even TB occurs in a healthy child.
Yes.
Okay. And in fact, if it happens in an healthy child, it would come strongly with an inflammatory response and even go further downhill. Okay. So, we'll wait to decide what it is. Right? Okay. Go ahead.
Fever during the initial 2 days was low grade, intermittent type, responding to medication. With the interfebrile period, she used to feel better and used to recur every 5 to 6 hours. From the third day of illness, fever progressed to being high grade, intermittent type. Though the temperature used to come down with the medication, she continued to feel sick and fever used to recur as before. There was also associated headache from the second day of illness, frontal and occipital region, and she described it to be more of heaviness than this thing. So that is how she described it to be. And it used to only partially relieve on taking medication. There was no chills and rigors present. From the fourth day of illness, she complains of feeling very tired, unable to do her daily activity. And most of the time she used to lie on down on the bed, sir.
So I think what is happening on this child is the fever pattern has changed. Now, when fever pattern has changed, you anticipate some complications occurring. Okay. Now, what complications we don't know as yet.
Yes.
But we did start saying that this is a low-grade infection. So, low-grade infection is causing some complication. When low-grade infection causes complication, it is rarely an extension of infection, but it is often a complication mediated through immune mechanism or sometimes toxin induced or sometimes metabolically induced. But rarely, what I mean is, suppose I'm dealing with a pneumonia and a child gets even worse in degree of fever and becomes more sick, I start looking for a possible empyema. But for that, I must have a story of a pneumonia-like illness. Here is a child who has got a low-grade fever that becomes suddenly high-grade. It is unlikely, same infection worsening, but it's likely some non-infective complications are occurring. Okay, I'll give you an example. A child has an illness like a dengue fever. He doesn't look very sick, but after 3-4 days, suddenly becomes sick. Not necessarily with high fever, but sickness, become drowsy. You know that he is getting into a dengue shock syndrome. Which, what is that? Immunological complication. Not extension of dengue virus, but a dengue virus triggered an immune complication. So this suggests that this infection seems to have led to an immune-mediated complication. Why not metabolic? Because the fever has become high. High fever is inflammation and immune disorders are inflammatory. Metabolic are not inflammation. Okay, I'll give you an example of a metabolic complication. A child starts with a simple viral infection, 1.5 year old. And after 2-3 days, fever seems to be getting a little better, but the child develops a convulsion without now having fever. This was a metabolic complication like hypocalcemia in a child who has already rickets and a viral infection tipped over that and caused hypocalcemic convulsion. That's a metabolic cause of convulsion. And I'll give you another example. A child starts with a bacillary dysentery and after 2-3 days, suddenly develops a drowsiness. What is that? Toxin-mediated Shigella dysentery. Okay, toxin and toxic encephalopathy. caused by the bacterial toxin, not the extension of infection, but toxemia. So toxins, metabolic, immune are such complications which are called non-infective complications. This looks like a non-infective complication. And now the child is getting tired, lying down in bed. Does it mean drowsiness or it means muscles are weak? What do you think? When you are tired, you mean muscles are tired. Okay.
Yes, weakness.
Now, but when you are drowsy also, you don't want to move.
Yes.
So we are not sure here whether he is drowsy or he is feeling tired. If he is not drowsy, alert, but tired, then it must be muscles are getting tired. And why should a muscle get tired? That means there is some metabolic changes occurring, which we did not expect in this child. So we keep it open at this point of time. And we are building a story right from thinking process on the first slide to now a second slide. And we feel that this must be an immune complications of some infection. But when you said muscles are tired, we are not sure whether this indicates mental tiredness, which is drowsiness, or whether it's a muscle tiredness. Okay, go ahead, go further.
Child then had vomiting on fifth day of illness, sudden onset, two episodes she had, sir, after having her food containing food particles, but it was non-projectile, non-bilious, and not blood-tinged. Then from fifth day of illness onwards, there has been progressive decrease in the level of consciousness in the child. She was initially, she was confused, then slowly she was not oriented, and that further progressed to being drowsy, and later on she only used to get up on waking her up. So that was the semiology. Then on the day of presentation morning, that was on the sixth day of illness, she had one episode of paroxysmal movements lasting for 1 to 2 minutes, involving all the four limbs, tonic-clonic type. The event occurred when she woke up in the morning, and post the episode, there was loss of consciousness for around 10 minutes. And after that, she has remained drowsy, sir. So no urinary or fecal incontinence or tongue bite happened during the episode.
Right. So what does this tell us? This tells us that there is an acute onset of a complication on day 4, day 5, which is very fastly progressive. What happens acutely is rarely due to infection. What happens acutely are metabolic, immune-mediated, vascular, neurogenic, and sometimes psychogenic, acute onset. If it is acute onset vascular, then it is going to present with a localized symptom or sign, because one vessel would be involved, not all vessels.
Okay.
So it is not vascular. Same thing about neurogenic. It could be one nerve or the other. So this is not. This is not metabolic because there is fever. So this is an immune-mediated encephalopathy. And fastly progressive. Acute onset on day 4, day 5, progressing to a fastly progressing encephalopathy, and starting with low-grade fever, builds up a story of a tuberculous meningoencephalitis. Okay. Now, something like TBM might be caused by any other organism or other diseases, but we are considering the most common type of illness that is prevalent in that. Now, at this point of time, do you think this child, she's 14-year-old, right?
Yes, sir, 14-year-old.
Now, is this child susceptible for acute onset tuberculosis? I said that immune complications are often seen in healthy children. Okay. Do you think that this child, yes, this yes. child is also an adolescent child. And if there was some previous tuberculous infection which was lying dormant, it could flare up with fast growth during adolescence, and she would suddenly flare up with an acute onset immunological complications. So we have so far reasonable background to build up in favor of TB meningoencephalitis. Okay, it could be something else also, but that we will know only further on examination, etc. Right? Okay, go ahead. Tell us what you have next to say. Yeah. What next? Yeah, go ahead. I can't hear you, Ashrain.
Am I audible, sir, now?
Yes, you are audible now. Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, sir. There was
no problem.
History of exposure to pets present in the house. There was no history of travel. No history of any head trauma or ear discharge, and there was no history of any abdominal pain, bleeding manifestations, passing black colored stools, swelling of the abdomen, or reduced urine output presence.
Fine. I think wait at this point of time. Now, what do you understand by exposure to pets? What are you thinking about?
Sir, to find out the etiological history that was asked, sir.
All right. But what types of history or diseases you are trying to find when there is an exposure to pets?
Rickettsial infection, sir.
All right.
Coming to our back, yes, sir.
Though generally not out of a pet, okay. But yes, we take a note of that. All right. It could be a dog who is not immunized. It could be rabies. So you take a note of that. But this must be a pet at home, well looked after. Probably it may not be related, but we'll keep in mind that. Now, when you give negative history, you must keep in mind two important things. One, the negative history should have a likelihood of being there related to what you have been thinking. Okay. And the second is, you should ask for such a history of negative history of such symptoms, which parents will forget to tell you. For example, you are right, no history of travel or trauma, because he might have fallen down some week or 2 weeks ago, and they might have said, oh, it was a mild trauma, but for you, that is important. So that part is fine. Ear discharge, yes, because you are thinking about complications intracranially. But why are you asking about abdominal pain, bleeding, etc.? What made you ask all that?
Sir, both dengue would have presented dengue with warning signs needing to dengue encephalitis could have been a possibility, sir, during these months. And Leptospira also could have been a possibility, sir, because of the rainy season that was there.
Very good.
These were the two things.
Very good. Though our story did not fit in very well, some such viral infection nor infection like a leptospira, but you are all right, because you are looking for complications of such an infection which has been so-called hidden, and immunological complications. Now, leptospira also has immunological complications, dengue also has immunological complications, and you are right in talking about it. But again, don't forget that if there was bleeding or passing black colored stool or swelling of abdomen, parents or the patient would not have missed it. missed it. But reduce urine output, they could miss it. Okay. So take a note of that. Many times, students give me a very long list of negative points. Though your history is very short and negative, I like that. But even out of the fourth component, you could take away swelling of abdomen, black colored stool, bleeding, and even severe abdominal pain. Urine output often missed by parents or patients. You might ask that, right? Okay, go ahead.
Yes, sir. So past history, no history of any previous hospitalization or nothing significant was present, sir.
All right.
Treatment history, the child was taken to a local clinic on the first day and was given paracetamol, sir, to be taken thrice a day. Due to deterioration in her general condition, she was again taken to the same clinic and was, that is what parents told, that it was an antibiotic. Later, they showed us that it was amoxicillin with clavulanic acid that was given, sir, and was asked to continue paracetamol. On the morning of the day she presented to our hospital, she was taken to Tumkur Government Hospital, sir. Over there, she was put on IV fluids, and that is what the referral letter showed us, sir. She was given one dose of injection ceftriaxone and given one loading dose of midazolam, sir. And then she was referred to our hospital for further management.
All right. Does that worry you about our thought process going wrong? Because we were not aware that she received amoxicillin very early in the course and ceftriaxone on almost the day of admission to your hospital. Do you think that should change our thinking process and consider it as an acute bacterial infection which has been modified in presentation because of an early introduction of an antibiotic? What do you think?
So that also could have been possible, or a bacterial infection which was treated, so it is not responding. So that might not have been a likely etiology. So something else was present. Right. That also could have been a possibility.
All right. So that ceftriaxone on the same day would not have altered anyway. And
yes, sir.
Amoxicillin may or may not have done anything. So we may not infer a great deal out of this. This is certainly doesn't look like a partially treated bacterial meningitis, because the child would have not worsened so badly all of a sudden. So we will not really worry about what was done, though certainly it was not done rightly, but we will not consider it as coming in our way of thinking. All right, go ahead.
So antenatal history, nothing, no significant antenatal, natal and postnatal history,
now,
sir.
Tell me on this, okay, you are correct to put all this, but tell me, in which type of disorder that you are facing, you like to know details of antenatal history on each 3-month period, okay, and ortho detailed birth history. You are a 14-year-old.
Considering encephalopathy, then it might have been of significance, sir.
So you would have said that if this child had a delayed milestone, developmental delay, then it would have been very, very important. Yes. But otherwise, you don't expect anything. So in an examination, you could say that I have got a detailed history of every trimester of pregnancy as well as at birth, and everything is normal. So just scratch it away. The examiner can ask you what all things that you ask in each trimester. You already know. You have put down all that very well. Right? Fine.
Yes.
Just talking about birth history, in this child, it has no relevance. But what do you ask birth history like? Okay. What do you ask birth history?
So whether the baby cried immediately after birth, sir.
All right. Now, can it be that baby cried immediately after birth but had a birth injury?
Yes, sir. Possible.
Then how do you fish that out? So my point is, history of birth process. Yeah.
History of ICU admissions.
Well, that may not be there. See, the commonest, one of the common causes of
delivery, sir.
Okay.
Instrument.
One of the common, instrument, okay. One of the common causes of a delayed development coming to your notice in a little older child is a hypoglycemia missed around the birth time, totally missed. And child progressed slowly, presented to you at 3, 5, or even 8 years of age with a poor school performance, and it could be due to a mild hypoglycemia missed totally because it did not cause a symptom of a seizure, but it was significant hypoglycemia. Okay, so I want you to understand that birth history has 2-3 important parameters. And what we are trying to find out in a neurological case, whether there was any brain damage around the birth process. That is our idea. It is called neonatal encephalopathy. Now, what question do you ask to determine whether the given child has had neonatal encephalopathy? Crying is yes, but crying is not a very strong
feeding
way. Excellent.
Whether the baby is to suck onto the mother's breast.
Absolutely, absolutely. And can you tell me the behavior of a normal baby delivered normally?
For normal baby, as soon as the baby is delivered, initial 3 to 4 hours, they're not used to the surroundings, so they'll be erratic cries, sir. Once that 3 to 4 hours is passed, then the baby gets used to its normal routine of 2 to 3 hours of sleep and then awakening for the milk. And initially 2 to 3 days, baby tends to sleep more during the day hours as compared to night. Then later on, the usual circadian rhythm will be.
Excellent. But one more thing you could have added, that babies at birth are awake for first 20 to 30 minutes, want to bond with the mother. That's the time you put the baby to the breast immediately. And thereafter, by attempting to suck, they show their alertness and activity and then go to sleep for the next few hours. And then you rightly said how the cycle goes on. So remaining awake for 20, 30 minutes is an important part of the behavior. I tell you how. Suppose the baby cried immediately, but never stopped crying. Continued crying. Oh, that's an encephalopathy. Baby cried immediately, but stopped crying, but thereafter went to sleep straight off. Did not remain awake for 20, 30 minutes. That's an encephalopathy. Okay, so take a note when you, especially this is important when you are looking at the cerebral palsy, that birth history only not for crying, a detailed behavior at birth, right? But this child, there is no question about it. Go ahead.
So developmental history, development of the child
normal.
Was appropriate for age. Yes, sir. And scholastic performance was average, sir.
Very
she
good.
Was immunized as well up to date. And coming to the diet history, there was
now,
no...
tell me, BCG is already taken. So is tuberculosis out from our discussion?
Sir.
Why not? He's immunized, no?
Yes, sir. But there is only up to 60 to 70% efficacy is present, sir. And it is for the initial few years, up to 12 to 13 years of her life, it protects against severe infection. So the likelihood of getting infection is still present, sir.
But in this case, you are considering a severe infection, right?
Yes, sir.
So now, would you rule that out because of BCG? You rightly said efficacy is not so good. Okay, protection is only partial, but you did also say that it protects you from severe illness. Okay, but this is a severe illness. So TB is out. What do you think?
But we are considering the immune manifestation of the body to the tubercular bacilli in our case. So still it is a possibility.
Very good. So what you meant was that BCG, whatever efficacy the BCG has in a given child, it protects you from severe illness only in the first year or two, not
yes.
thereafter. Okay, so you said rightly. Okay, what about the calories? And
she was having adequate calories and proteins were present,
so,
sir.
So no problem.
No
so
problem.
Now, okay, so now give me your diagnosis on the history only. Summarize the history diagnosis.
History diagnosis.
Yeah. All this is fine. Go ahead.
14-year-old girl child was brought to a casualty with history of fever from 6 days, vomiting and altered sensorium from 1 day and one episode of abnormal movements in the morning. So with this, would like to consider the child is suffering from acute onset meningoencephalitis, probably of infectious etiology, sir.
Absolutely right. Very good. You could have added. So when you summarize, you use a lot of adjectives. So you could have said that this 14-year-old child started with what looked like a low-grade infection, which suddenly became high and had a progressive encephalopathy, preceded by symptoms of meningitis. And therefore, I feel this child has got an acute onset, fastly progressive meningoencephalitis, probably of an infective etiology. What infection? You say maybe tuberculosis. Okay, at this point, but your summary is fine. Okay, let's see your examination findings.
Yes, so she was brought to our hospital in a stretcher and she was actively convulsing, sir. So we have put the triangle and the pentagon, sir. Child was actively convulsing, GTCS type, involving all the four limbs. She was having irregular breathing efforts and she was cyanosed. Bleeding in the oral cavity was present because of the tongue bite. And there was pooling of secretions and airway was maintainable by simple measures. Respiratory rate was 30 cycles per minute. SpO2 was 85% under room air. Irregular bilateral air entry equal. Drooling of saliva with gurgling sounds was present, sir, along with conducted sounds. So coming to circulation, pulse rate was 100 beats per minute. Good volume. All peripheral and central pulses were felt. BP was 100 by 60 mmHg. Appeared cyanosed. Altered sensorium was present and urine output on catheterization, adequate urine output was present, sir. There was decreased level of consciousness, generalized tonic-clonic seizures involving all the four limbs, and she was responding only to painful stimulation. And temperature was 98.6 degree Fahrenheit. Active bleeding was present from the oral cavity, sir, due to tongue bite.
All right. Fine.
So child was initially stabilized, airway breathing and circulation taken care. The seizure was aborted with midazolam followed by single loading dose of levetiracetam, sir. Then on examination, after stabilization, child was sick looking, lying on the bed, not oriented to time, place and person. Vitals, temperature was 100 degree Fahrenheit. Pulse rate was 102 beats per minute. Good volume, all peripheral pulses felt. Respiratory rate, 26 cycles per minute. BP was 104 by 76 mmHg, SpO2 was 99% with 2 liters of oxygen, and GRBS was 138 milligrams per deciliter. Head-to-toe examination, there was icterus present, sir, and no pallor, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy, or edema. Rest of the examination was normal, sir.
Fine. So now, anthropometry, that was normal, right? Anthropometry.
Yes.
All right. So at this point of time now, what is your impression?
Now there is likely multi-system involvement, sir, because over here liver as well is getting involved, sir, because icterus is also present.
All right. So then what? So what's your possible etiology now?
Now we are thinking something other than tubercular.
Very good. Very good.
Yes, sir.
So what are you thinking now?
So with icterus, we can again think of leptospira can be a possibility.
All right.
A rickettsial infection can be a possibility, sir.
All right.
Then so, sir, malaria can also be a possibility.
All right. All right. Now, will you put all these in some order of priority? TB is out now. Okay,
yes,
but why do you think TB doesn't cause icterus? After all, TB affects all organs, no?
Yes, sir.
Intestines are affected, adrenals are affected, kidneys are affected, bone is affected. Okay, why not liver?
But very less likely, sir.
But still possible?
Yes, sir. But not. Not aware, sir.
All right. So your answer would be, in tuberculosis of liver, it's a localizing lesion. TB is a localized disease. Does not affect the entire organ. Okay. For example, yes, in the lungs, it is one part of the lung which is first starts involving. So in liver, unless 85% of hepatocytes are damaged, you don't get jaundice. So in other words, jaundice is a manifestation of an extensive hepatocyte involvement. And TB has a localized hepatocyte involvement, if at all. Like liver abscess has no jaundice. Like hydatid cyst has no jaundice. Like hepatoblastoma has no jaundice. So all localized diseases in the liver never have jaundice. And therefore, TB also has almost never have jaundice, with one exception, which is extremely rare and not even worth considering. If you have a large tuberculous lymph nodes at the porta hepatis and that obstructs the biliary tract, then you will get a biliary obstruction and therefore jaundice, but not hepatocyte jaundice, biliary jaundice. But that's extremely rare, so we will not much talk about it. But if examiner asks you, is it possible? Then you said, yes, rarely. I've never seen one, but lymph nodes at the porta hepatis could cause, in which case the problem may present with ichthyosis. Now here, what was the liver size like?
But there was no hepatomegaly, sir. That was the contrasting thing, sir.
So now if there was
no... make up both hepatomegaly and splenomegaly, sir.
So now if there was no hepatomegaly, classically in a leptospiral complication, you could have expected hepatomegaly. So now, could it be Deng doing it? So my question is, does Deng have jaundice? And if Deng has jaundice, then it's a viral hepatitis, and hepatitis has mostly enlarged liver. Okay. Now, are you sure this liver is not enlarged? For example, I'll give you an example. You said liver is not palpable for abdomen, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, could it be that there is an eventration of diaphragm on the right side and the entire enlarged liver is sitting in the thorax only? How are you sure about that?
Then by percussion, we should have.
Yeah, so always talk about the upper border of the liver. Okay?
Yes.
And make sure that you have no hepatomegaly. Though generally, hepatomegaly is a palpable, abdominal palpable hepatomegaly. But occasionally, one could be just fooled totally with something of that kind. So now we have a problem. If we call hepatitis either infective, like a viral, tubercle doesn't cause it. Or it could be immune-mediated, like in leptospira, we would have normally expected hepatomegaly. But that alone cannot throw our possible diagnosis. So we will have to now investigate. Okay. Because this child started with low-grade fever. Generally, Deng or leptospira do start with high fever. Okay. But we said low-grade viral could be there. The type of meningoencephalitis is not common in typical Deng, because Deng has a capillary leak and complication, but not headache, vomiting, and then encephalopathy. That looks a little unusual for Deng. Leptospira could do that.
So leptospira, can we have meningitis as a presentation in the iatric part, sir?
See, it's unusual. The common complication of leptospira are largely hepatic and renal, but even neurological complications are known. So we'll keep options open. Tubercle goes out because of ichthyosis completely. Okay.
Yes, sir.
But remaining things stay with us and we will have to investigate and see what they are. So now tell me, what investigation would you do in this child?
Sir, in the present stage investigation, CBC we would have done, sir.
Okay, can you show us the results?
Yes, sir. So before, can I summarize the CNS?
Yes, findings? Yes. Very good. Very good. I forgot to ask you that. Please summarize. Yes. Please summarize.
So neurological examination, GCS was poor, so 11 by 15 with okay. E3, V4 and M4, not all oriented right. to time, place and person. Cranial okay. nerve examination from whatever we could examine was normal, so there were no deficits
all right.
present. And on motor system examination, significant finding was there was hypertonia presence in both upper and lower limbs.
All right.
Power was poor. Power was present 2/5, sir. And really? Reflexes were increased, sir. 3+ were the reflexes, sir. Along with extensor plantar reflex, sir.
Now, why was she having a loss of power?
So might be because of her. We couldn't elicit, sir, because of her drowsiness.
So don't say loss of power.
Yes, sir.
Because the moment you say loss of power, your diagnosis is going to change totally.
Yes, sir.
So you would say that power could not be tested correctly because of severe drowsiness. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So don't say 2/5. 2/5 would raise a question that this child has a definite paresis, which is not expected. But yes, rest sir. Of it is expected. All right. Fine. What else?
Yes, sir. Sensory was normal. The meningeal signs were present, sir. Neck rigidity okay. on flexion of the neck, she was wincing. And Koenig's and Brzezinski sign was positive.
Now,
sir.
Even here, sensory response to deep painful stimuli, maybe, right?
Yeah. Yes, sir. Painful all stimuli right. was present.
All right. All right.
To painful all stimuli right. was present.
Okay. All right. What next?
Yes, sir. That hepatomegaly couldn't make out.
One more. Yes. You did not tell me whether this child had signs of increased intracranial pressure.
Yes, sir. So on fundus examination, we had done, sir. Fundus examination was normal, sir.
But evaluation that might take some time to show papillary. Okay. Yes, so, sir. We are there not sure. No
hypertension was not there, sir.
Very good. Very good.
Bradycardia was not there.
Very good.
Yes, sir.
Was there a McEwen sign?
McEwen sign. Okay, sir. We did not elicit.
What is McEwen sign?
McEwen sign. So we tried to tap over the
skull.
Temporal area and see, sir. If it is more resonant, then we can think of crackpot resonance. We call
very
it,
good.
Sir.
Very raised good.
ICT. Yes,
very
sir.
Good. So now tell me, do you expect in this child a crackpot sound?
Yes, sir. We can expect raised intracranial tension because of the increased edema. Secondary to immunological mediated damage, we can expect increased ICT to be present, sir.
See, typically, a raised ICT is not severe in just a brain cell edema. Symptomatically, yes, there could be one vomit, there could be irritability. But for a McEwen sign for a cracked pot to occur in suture separation, you need a lot of raised ICT. That happens commonly in a meningoencephalitis with hydrocephalus.
Hydrocephalus, yes.
And hydrocephalus adds to the raised ICT more than encephalopathy or a brain cell edema. And therefore, if this child has a hydrocephalus, then the diagnosis is possibly not leptospira or a dengue or whatever we are discussing. Hydrocephalus with a meningoencephalitis is commonly tubercle, but the icterus should not have been there. So in short, we would not have expected McEwen sign in this side. All right? Okay. Now summarize your total history and finding.
Yes, sir. Finally, diagnosis, it's a case of acute encephalitis syndrome with features of meningitis, probably secondary to rickettsia, leptospira, dengue, or cerebral malaria, or other cause of viral meningoencephalitis.
I nearly agree with your priorities. Okay. For yes, everything, you must tell me what is against a possible diet. Now, what is against rickettsia?
What is against rickettsia?
For I know, because acute encephalitic syndrome is rickettsia and you have put yes, that sir. As first. So that's yes, all sir. Right. What is against it?
Sir, on examination, eschar we could have found, sir, that is not present in
but
this child.
But often eschar is difficult
around 60% of the times only eschar will be present.
So,
sir.
Absence of eschar may not rule out rickets. Then what else? So, the rickets often has
rashes would have been present, sir.
Okay. And often gangrenous rash. There is a vasculitic complication, okay, which is lacking. So we'll keep that in mind. What is against leptospira?
Against leptospira, hepatorenal involvement is not prominent in our child, sir.
Okay.
Because urine output is good in this child, sir, still.
Okay. Yes, all right. Sir. And even neurological syndrome is unusual, but yes, icterus is often present. So you have possible. What about dengue?
The dengue leak phase symptoms are not present, sir, in this child. And fever would have started reducing by now, sir, by 6 to 7 day of illness.
All right. And again, no rash.
And, no rash, yes, sir.
Okay. And dengue typically have two types of complication, either a shock or a hemorrhage. Okay.
Yes,
this child has something different, so less likely. What about cerebral malaria?
So cerebral malaria, again, unlikely, sir. The pattern of fever would have been erratic and associated chills and rigors would have been present, sir.
And why what are
other causes of viral meningoencephalitis like JE virus could have been present, sir. But that would have been a more severe presentation than this, sir.
Yeah. And typically viral infections have two different types of neurological illness. One is a totally a meningitis without encephalitis. That happens in a little older child and quickly gets better even without treatment. That is called aseptic meningitis.
Aseptic meningitis.
Okay.
Yes,
but they have no encephalopathy. And the other extreme is they come with an encephalitis very early in the course of a neurotrophic viral infection. This child has taken the course of a meningoencephalitis. Therefore, again, look at all the lower three ones. Meningoencephalitis has meningitis also. So here, in your first sentence, you could have said a case of an acute meningoencephalitis.
Yes.
Because you have a neck stiffness also. And you have a symptoms of headache, vomiting. So if you put meningoencephalitis, then your last three possibly go out. And you remain with possibly a rickettsia leptospira as a possibility, all right?
Yes,
but all that is right to include because, see, medicine is a science of uncertainty. And therefore, it should be an art of probability. That's what William Osler said 125 years ago. Even today, with all modern gamuts of investigations and advances in medicine, medicine continues to be uncertain and therefore an art of probability. Okay, what a tremendous thing. When this statement was made, there was no much advance in medicine. And today, after 125 years, science had advanced and we are still talking about what was mentioned 125 years ago. Does it mean we have not improved at all? Possibly, yes. So, superficially, we have done remarkably well. We have advanced so much, but we don't seem to have advanced in our thought process. Okay, we have an advanced technology, but we have not advanced in thinking. That's what it means, possibly. Fine. What investigations have you done? So, does this give you any idea where we are?
Yes, sir. So total counts were raised with lymphocytic predominance was present, sir. Eosinopenia as well was noted. And there was low platelet count, sir. Platelet count was only 20,000. So thrombocytopenia was present, sir.
Fine. So now tell me, which one of those five things you push yourself onto?
Sir, again, rickettsia and leptospira comes with thrombocytopenia, sir.
So we continue to have both of them with us so far. All right.
Yeah.
TB is out already with icterus. So we are out. What next?
So, but there was no renal involvement, sir. Renal parameters were
all right. Normal. All right.
And serum electrolytes were also normal, sir. So unlikely any metabolic complication.
All right.
So, total bilirubin and indirect bilirubin, sir. Sorry, that is not direct. 5.65 and on by 2 to 3 days of illness, it had reduced, sir. 2.8 it was, sir.
Oh, okay. Now, what does
ASP,
that mean?
ASP, ALT was raised.
Yeah.
And ALP was also mildly raised, sir.
Now, what does that mean? You have an AST more than ALT. And you are talking about a liver disease where ALT should have been more.
More than AST, yes, sir. So, mostly it's 5.65 might have not have been a correct value, sir. It might have been a spurious value and 2.8 would have been...
All right, doesn't matter. But what I mean is, why AST is more than ALT? And that will also answer why we always do AST, ALT together.
Other involvement also could have been present, sir.
No, exactly. In fact, when AST is definitely more than ALT, you know that the liver disease is a part of a systemic disease.
Yes, sir.
And that favors our rickettsia, leptospira, whatever you are talking. It's not an isolated liver disease. It's something beyond that. And that is why AST is higher than ALT. But the child is improving fast. Okay.
Yes.
So now take a note of that, that he's improving fast. Okay. We will talk about it a little after next few slides. What else did you do?
And for PTA INR, was slightly deranged, sir. Not any remarkable derangement was PTI. So coagulopathy was not there. And CRP okay. was raised, sir. So again, immune-mediated damage right. could have been there, sir.
All right.
And all of them were decreasing trend. So the child has responded.
Okay. Have you done a CSF?
Yes, sir. CSF was done, sir.
Yeah.
So CSF was done after the platelets were normalized. Sir. So there was slight delay in CSF studies. Around 5th day it was done. And CSF studies showed what 0.5 ml clear fluid was there. Two cells were there with predominant lymphocytes. Sir. And sugar was 45 and protein was 75, sir. So CSF study was normal, sir.
All right. Okay.
And CSF
Now, which means that there were no evidence of meningitis on day 5.
Yes,
because
sir.
CSF was normal. So now we have an encephalitis only. Though the story sounded like a meningoencephalitis, we are now putting up only encephalitis. And encephalitis which came on day 5, day 6, almost always means a primary problem extraneural and a complication immunological. That's where rickettsia, leptospira start coming in. All right.
Yes, sir. And CSF serology that we had sent turned out to be normal, sir. But the blood which had sent for serology, it was IgM positive for scrub typhus and chikungunya, sir.
Both. So now we don't know whether both have complicated the issue or what, but we have no idea. But good. Whereas the dengue was negative, malaria was negative, and reasonably, but you haven't looked at leptospira as yet.
So in the both serology, we had sent for leptospira also, sir. CSF and...
Okay. And that was negative.
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right. So now tell me, looks like that you have diagnosed rickettsia and chikungunya was just an accompanying fellow, might have even made it
cross-reactive.
Okay.
Yes.
But now do you think that this IgM could be not very dependable?
So then, possible, sir. There is chance of cross-reactivity, sir.
Yeah, but we will have to take it because our story now fits in the rickettsia. And therefore, we will consider this as a reasonable thing. Now, what treatment did you get?
Yes, sir. So this was the MRI brain that
All
was
right.
done.
So Very good.
There was...
Yeah,
the,
go ahead.
As we have shown as the pointer, sir, there was slight restriction of diffusion in the right parieto-occipital region, sir. And this was also done on a delayed, so it was not done immediately because she had to be intubated due because of further deterioration in the level of consciousness, sir, on the day of admission. She was initially empirically started on ceftriaxone, acyclovir, doxycycline, and artesunate, sir. But later on, only we continued doxycycline for 10 days, sir.
Very good. Now, justify giving all four drugs to begin with.
Yes, sir. So, because these are the most likely probable etiologies on the day of presentation, we had started with empirically with the these four drugs, sir.
Could you not wait for a day or two before you got your results?
So, but her deterioration was too quick, sir. She had to be intubated.
Absolutely. You would have said that even if she was not so bad, you could have started with all four drugs because this is a potential dangerous situation. And you have to save life first. If you try to be very rational in such a situation, it itself is irrational. So what you have done is very right. Even if the child was not deteriorating, but you had not to wait for a deterioration. And this is a standard way of looking at it. Okay, but moment you found CSF normal, your ceftriaxone could have been out. Okay,
yes, sir.
And in the next day or two, you got some IgM positive, you stopped everything, right? So, fine. What about the levetiracetam?
Sir, because of some neurological damage or neurological sequelae, it might have left. So, we continue it for usually 3 months, get an EEG done, and then usually stop.
Why 3 months? So she's improved remarkably, no? She's improved remarkably.
Yes, sir. Or probably we could have got an EEG done at that point of time, and then also we could have looked at stopping the drugs, sir.
So your answer would have been any acute brain damage resulting in a seizure, okay, is likely to have a recurrence of seizure for the next 3 months, even if the primary disease gets totally cured. This is the story, for example, same for a head trauma. If a child who had a head trauma has a seizure, you would possibly give the anticonvulsant for 3 months. What does it mean? Epidemiologically, any acute symptomatic seizure has a risk of recurrence in the first 3 months. Thereafter, the risk of recurrence is very low, though could occur even after months or years. But for that, you can't go on giving drugs for a long time. So it is a routine that if a head injury patient comes with a seizure, you will give anticonvulsant for 3 months. Same is the story here. Acute symptomatic seizure needs an anticonvulsant for 3 months. Exception, acute metabolic seizure. For example, you have a hypocalcemic seizure, is an acute symptomatic seizure, but that will not continue because hypocalcemia is one-time event. It doesn't damage. But if there is any damage, you would rather continue it for 3 months, irrespective of an EEG. EEG may be normal. Even then, you should continue. Fine. So otherwise,
on discharge, in case if EEG is available, if there is no significant MRI finding and EEG being normal, should we continue or like should we, can so we discontinue?
Even, that was for example, see, the point is, an imaging only tells you the structure of the brain and a damage in terms of structure, but not function. EEG tells you whether there is an active focus, but it doesn't tell you whether there is a dormant focus. Dormant focus has to be triggered by something. For example, you know that if at 5 years onwards, a child suddenly develops a generalized seizure and recovers completely, you call it very likely an idiopathic epilepsy, right? Today, yes, we know that such idiopathic epilepsy is a genetically determined disorder. And you have a focus in your brain, which you are born with. but it manifests sometime later because of some known or unknown factor. And your EEG may be normal. Therefore, generally, even when you suspect an epilepsy, you do an EEG in a particular manner so that even the hidden focus is observed on the electroencephalogram. And what are those triggers?
Sleep deprivation.
Excellent. What yes. else? Photic stimulation.
Photic okay. stimulation. Yes.
Now, so you make a dormant focus manifest on an electroencephalogram. So functionally, you have to trigger a focus that is not seen. Now, an EEG normal, therefore, does not rule out an epilepsy because the focus may be dormant and you have not triggered it by routine measures of triggering. That's why the limitation of EEG. If EEG is abnormal, you can follow it up with another EEG after 3 or 6 months to demonstrate that that abnormal focus has disappeared. But final decision of stopping anticonvulsant for acute symptomatic seizure is 3 months, and for an idiopathic epilepsy for about 2 years, okay, or 18 months. Now, this is done by epidemiological understanding, how large number of patients would get better by that kind of thing. And this is done everywhere. For example, a first episode of nephrotic syndrome is treated for 6 weeks full dose and another 4 weeks an alternate day morning dose. Okay, even if the child is all right in the first week or two. Why do we do that? Because the epidemiological observations have shown that when you treat the first episode of nephrotic syndrome in this standard prolonged therapy, the chances of recurrence go down. But the subsequent episodes of a relapsed nephrotic syndrome are not treated with long-term steroids. They are given only for a short term. Because now you've already got a body which is known to relapse, okay, or respond by relapsing. So this is the way. How do you decide 6 months of anti-TB treatment for every child, even if he gets well within 4 weeks? Again, the same observation that chances of recurrence or reactivation is less than 1% if you complete the treatment for 6 months. Same way, 3 months of anticonvulsant for an acute symptomatic seizure. All right? Good. Yeah. I think, Ashra, you did very well. Yes. I'm very happy. But I wanted to show you how we started off thinking right from your first slide. And because of low-grade fever, we were likely discussing TB as one possibility. Though we said low-grade, any infection could do that. But generally, leptospira, rickettsia are all high-grade infections. It is rare for them to present with low-grade. What does it mean? Many times, low and high-grade are not very dependable. Though, yes, we depend on that history. And you always say, to begin with, you also said, history reliable, given by the mother. I remember once Dr. Srinivasan from Pondicherry asked a student whether mother can be unreliable. And he said, why do you have to say reliable from mother? Mother is always reliable. That's a different story. But we are used to saying history is reliable. Now, if I ask you as a student, what makes you think it is reliable? You have no answer. But I know that mother is always reliable. And therefore, it is enough to say, history taken by the mother, which yes. is always reliable. All right, good.
Yes.
Any more questions? Good. So I think we have done a good job, but I again want the White Army organizers to bring more students on the live platform.
Yes, sir. We are trying, sir.
Yeah. But Ashraya, are you the only one who are so brave to face every question and you did it so well. Now many others may have same potential ability, but they themselves don't know that they are so good. How will they know they are so good? Only when they come on a live screen. So now tell your colleague that even you could be doing so well, why should they not? You are not the only best student of your college. There are many others too. So I want people like you who have very bravely come alone on this platform. I think it needs a lot of guts. And how do you have a lot of guts? Because you are confident. Even if you make mistake, you make it confidently. So that the person like me who hears starts wondering whether what you say is right or what I think is right. That kind of confidence you have. Okay. And you get more and more confidence when you face live program, right? So yes, I think you stimulate your colleague, and I would be happy if on White Army some more people come. But yeah, at least they should come on a chat very, very strongly. But yes, today, sir, we didn't have much on chat as well. Now, for being on chat, you don't have to show your face, right? So
yes,
I want people like you who have already come on the live platform to stimulate others. When everybody talks, everybody learns. When only you and me talk, almost very few learn, right?
Yes, sir. Sir.
Thank
sir.
You very much. Back to the organizers.
Yes, sir. Thank you.